Very good morning to everybody. Today we'll see about the hemodynamic disorders. Hemodynamic disorders. Okay, so we'll see the word meaning of hemodynamics. Hemo means blood, dynamics means flow or movement. Okay, so what will be the definition? It is the study of the blood flow. So in the definition wise, it deals with the blood flow through the circulatory system. As we know in the physiology, blood means nothing but the fluid connective tissue. So it is a blood means nothing but one component of the fluid. What about the another component? So we'll study in detail. Okay, the human containing two part of the for our purpose, we are dividing into the two part. One is the fluid part, another part is the solid part. Solid part is nothing but the skeletal, bones, tissue, everything. Okay. So fluid part, for our concern, it is a fluid part. So 60% of the fluid part and 40% is other part. Okay. Fluid part, okay, we are dividing into two part, extracellular fluids and intracellular fluids. Intracellular fluids consist of 33% and extracellular fluid consists of 27%. What is meant by intracellular fluid? Intracellular fluid means the fluid which contains inside the cell. It is known as the intracellular fluid. What is extracellular fluid? The fluid containing outside the cell is known as the extracellular fluid. Okay, so again we'll divide this extracellular fluid, again divided into extravascular fluid and intravascular fluid. This intravascular fluid, otherwise known as the blood or plasma. Okay, so it carries only 5% of the total fluid content. Okay, so this EVF, extravascular fluid, again divided into three types. Interstitial fluid, that is the 12%, and mesenchymal tissue and transcellular fluid. What is interstitial fluid? Interstitial fluid is fluid present between the cells. Fluid is present between the cells, that carries the 12%. What is mesenchymal tissue? Mesenchymal tissue is nothing but dense connective tissue containing some of the fluid, like the bones, cartilages, containing the fluids. That is the mesenchymal tissue. Transcellular fluid. Transcellular fluid means fluid within epithelial lining space. The example is CSF, lymph, everything is the examples of transcellular fluid. That carries the 1%. So this interstitial fluid is very important for our study. Okay, so interstitial fluid is 12% and it is a interstitial fluid is a component of the extravascular fluid, and intravascular fluid, extravascular fluid is a component of the extracellular fluid. Okay, now we'll study. So this is the fluid component. This is the blood vessels. This is the blood vessels. Inside the blood vessels, we have the plasma. So that is the intravascular fluid, plasma. Okay, and interstitial fluid means the fluid which is present between the cells. It is known as the interstitial fluid. So for our purpose, for our coming study, this two thing is required. Interstitial fluid and intravascular fluid is a component of the extracellular fluid, ECF. Okay, and what is intracellular fluid? The fluid which is present inside the cell is known as the intracellular fluid. Okay, so we'll study. Further we'll study. Okay, so what is the classification of the hemodynamic disorders? So classification of the hemodynamic disorder based on the three part. One is disturbance of the body fluids, another one is disturbance of the electrolytes, and third one it is disturbance of the circulations. Okay, disturbance of the body fluid. Okay, so that divided into edema, overhydration and dehydration. Today we'll cover the topic of edema. Okay, so disturbance of electrolytes, when it comes to the metabolic disorders, I will explain in detail. Okay, so disturbance of the circulation. Okay, so that we divided into the two component. One is under the volume, another one is under the obstruction. Okay, under the volume, we are discussing to the hyperemia, congestion, hemorrhage and shock. So that we'll discuss into the next class. Okay, obstruction means thrombosis, embolism, ischemia and infarctions. Okay, this is the total classification of the hemodynamic disorders. We'll study one by one. Okay, today we'll study the what is edema. Okay, edema means, the definition wise, it is defined as abnormal and excessive accumulation of the fluid in the interstitial tissue space. Okay, we have studied about the component, abnormal and fluid collection into the interstitial tissue space. Okay, let me explain very simple thing. Okay, so this is the intravascular fluid and interstitial fluids we know, and this is the intracellular fluids. Okay, this IF and intravascular fluid is a component of the extracellular fluid. Okay, so what is the edema? Edema means fluid accumulation into the interstitial space. Okay, interstitial space. Normally fluid will be there. How much fluid will be there? If you take the 60 kilogram of the adult containing around 11 liter of the fluid, interstitial fluids. So when the fluid accumulation is abnormal, it is known as the edema. There is the one more term we have studied, it is overhydration. So overhydration means what? So this is a very simple difference between edema and overhydration. Overhydration means that is also fluid accumulation, but where the location is different. The fluid accumulation inside the cell, okay, that is known as the overhydration. Fluid accumulation into the interstitial fluid, it is known as the edema. So if you see the very very different thing, plasma and interstitial fluid are having very similar solutes. Okay, this interstitial fluids and plasma is a component of the extracellular fluid. So that containing the more or less a similar component, where there is the intracellular fluid and extracellular fluid. Okay, this is the intracellular fluid, this is the intracellular fluid, this is extracellular fluid. This two containing the different solutes. Okay, and another difference is this plasma and interstitial fluid. Okay, transport of the fluid by the pressure gradient, that is HP and PCOP. Okay, we'll study later. Okay, intracellular and extracellular fluid transport, this between this intracellular and extracellular fluid transport by sodium potassium ATPS pump. Here it is, energy is required for transporting from the extracellular fluids to the intracellular fluid. So overhydration means, very simple understanding, fluid present into the inside the cell, where the fluid is present into the interstitial space, it is known as the edema. Okay, so we'll study what is the normal fluid exchange. Normal fluid exchange, where it is happening, the fluid exchange is happening into the capillaries. Okay, so let me explain with the normal. Okay, so this is about the artery, this is about the vein, and this is about the arterioles. Okay, and this is the venules. Okay, so here it is the center, it is the capillaries. So here only the fluid exchange is taking place. Okay, the fluid exchange is taking place by the two pressure, one is hydrostatic pressure and PCOP, plasma colloid osmotic pressure. So we have studied into the inflammation. Again, I am making very clear. So HP, this is a normal. Let me talk about the normal, then we'll go for the abnormal. Okay, so hydrostatic pressure. Okay, every this two end, arteriole end having hydrostatic pressure and PCOP, and venule also having HP and a PCOP. Okay, in the arterial end, okay, what is the function of HP? Is the outward motion. Outward motion means fluid will go from the arterioles to outside. Okay, that is outward motion, pushing the fluid into the outward motion. What is PCOP? PCOP helping for the inward motion. The fluid goes to from the interstitial fluids to the blood vessels. So this is known as the this is the function of PCOP. Okay, so what is in the arteriole end? Arteriole end, hydrostatic pressure is 30 and PCOP is the 24 millimeter of mercury. Where there is in the venule end, HP is 20 millimeter of mercury and PCOP is 24 millimeter of mercury. Okay, what happened here in the normal fluid exchange? What happened? So here hydrostatic pressure is increased. So what happened? 30 minus 24, 6. So 6 millimeter of mercury of water will come out. Okay, here is a 20 minus 24, that means minus 4. So 4% of 4 millimeter of mercury of water will go inside, because PCOP is increased here. So 4 will go to inside, 6 will come out. Okay, so 6 minus 4 is a 2. So 2 where will go? This 2 will go to the lymphatics. This 2 will go to the lymphatics. As we know, this lymphatics drainage into the vein. Okay, so this is the normal fluid exchange. So from here we have to understand the fluid movement by the two factor, hydrostatic pressure and plasma colloid osmotic pressure. As we know, hydrostatic pressure is based on the water content and PCOP is based on the protein content. So difference between water and protein, that the fluid exchange is taking place. This is the normal fluid exchange. So we'll study what happened. So from here we can understand normal fluid exchange based on the hydrostatic pressure, that is based on the water, and plasma colloid osmotic pressure, that is based on the protein, and role of lymphatics, and the last one, sodium and water retention. So this is the four cause responsible for the fluid exchange. Okay, now we'll go for the cause. The same thing only, we'll describe one by one. Okay, increased hydrostatic pressure. Okay, where there is, we have seen into the photo, where there is increased hydrostatic pressure. Okay, increased hydrostatic pressure. Suppose the increased hydrostatic pressure is increased, what happened? So much fluid will come out. Okay, and or otherwise decreased PCOP. So what happened? Suppose decreased PCOP, what happened? The fluid will not go to inside. So that is the two main causes of thing. So increased hydrostatic pressure, the main cause is the inflammation, as we discussed into the previous inflammatory chapters. So that is arterial dilatations. Okay, next one, it is a impaired venous return. So impaired venous return means so much fluid, there is obstruction of the venous system. Okay, obstruction of the venous system. So what happened? The fluid exchange will not happen. So what is the condition? Okay, congestive heart failure. Okay, and liver cirrhosis. This is the two causes for the responsible for the impaired venous return. So this is the symbol of increased hydrostatic pressure. So what about this? Decreased plasma colloid osmotic pressure. Okay, decreased plasma colloid osmotic pressure. That is a decreased PCOP. So when to call PCOP? Total plasma protein. Okay, when goes to less than 5 grams. Per deciliter, what is the normal? 6 to 8 gram per deciliter is a normal. When goes to less than 5, so the PCOP will be decreases. Or albumin is goes less than 2.5. What is the normal? 3.5 to 5 gram per deciliter is a normal. So when goes to less than 2.5, so PCOP will be decreases. What not the condition? You can see PCOP will be decreases. So liver cirrhosis, protein losing enteropathy, and malnutrition. So this is all the condition where PCOP will be decreases. This condition will be fulfilled. Okay. Then role of lymphatics. We have seen that 2% of 2 millimeter of mercury of water will be transferred to the venous system. Where there is obstruction of the lymphatics can leads to edema. So what are all the condition? There are 3 conditions. Inflammatory edema. Okay. Neoplastic edema. So that we'll discuss into the next chapter. And post surgical obstruction. Lymphatic obstruction. This is the role of the lymphatics. Okay. So, fourth one, sodium and water retention. Okay. What and all the thing? As we know into the normal thing, sodium and water retention is based on this system. Renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. Okay. By short they will call RAAS. Okay. So, when this is increases, so what happened? When this will increases, so much water and sodium will be retention in our body. So, that leads to edema. Okay, acute glomerular nephritis. So you know acute glomerular nephritis means inflammation of the glomerular part of the kidney. So what happened? Fluid exchange will not be proper, so water will be accumulated into the body. That leads to edema. Okay, third one it is renal hypofunction. Hypofunction means the kidney will not do the proper function, that leads to accumulation of the sodium and water retention. So this and all is the four causes of the edema. Okay, we'll study the simple pathogenesis. Okay, so it's very interesting one, very easy to remember. Okay, pathogenesis. So what is a pathogenesis? So you know we have studied about increased this protein deficiency or decreased hepatic protein synthesis in the hepatic. So these two causes can make to decreased PCOP. Okay, that means plasma colloid osmotic pressure and CCF, congestive heart failure. Okay, so what happened? When the decreased PCOP, that leads to decreased blood volume. Okay, so if the decreased blood volume, okay, what is a normal blood volume? It's a 5 liter. So that blood volume is decreased, that leads to decreased cardiac output. Okay, so that decreased cardiac output, what happened? That will activation of the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system and activation of this RAS. Okay, that leads to increased renal absorption of sodium and H2O. Okay, that leads to increased plasma volume. So the patients will get edema. This type of edema is known as the transudation. We'll study what is mean by transudation. Another one is exudation. We'll study what is that. Okay, so this is the decreased PCOP leads to edema. Okay, another one. Okay, when the decreased blood volume is decreased, what happened? The chronic hypoxia. Hypoxia means less oxygen in the blood vessels. Okay, that leads to what happened? Endothelial damage. The endothelium is the lining of the blood vessels. Okay, so what happened? The less oxygen, that leads to endothelial damage. That leads to increased vascular permeability, as we discussed a lot in the case of inflammation in the previous chapter. Okay, increased vascular permeability. That leads to, as we discussed, increased vascular permeability lead to edema. That type of fluid is known as the exudation. We'll study what is going to be exudation in later. Okay, so there is another mechanism. Okay, so this is the mechanism, this is the one mechanism, and this is the second mechanism. Third mechanism is congestive cardiac failure. What happened? Leads to increased central venous pressure. Okay, so what happened? Congestive cardiac failure mainly into the right side and left side. So what happened? That is the heart is a nothing but pump. So this pump is not working. What happened? The pressure into the central venous pressure is increased. That leads to increased capillary hydrostatic pressure. As we discussed, hydrostatic pressure is increased. That leads to edema. So this is the third option. Okay, what will be the another one? Okay, when the congestive cardiac failure leads to, there is a right side of the heart will be deficient, that the right side of the heart is not functioning. What happened? So much blood will be accumulated into the pulmonary regions. So that what happened? Increased pulmonary vasculature pressure. Okay, vascular pressure of the pulmonary regions will be increases. That leads to what happened? Increased HP. That HP means hydrostatic pressure. That leads to edema. This is the simple pathogenesis of the edema. Okay, we will study what is the types of edema. So types of edema, for our purpose, we divide into the three types: localized and generalized, transudate and exudate, and last one, it is a pitting and non-pitting. So we will study one by one what is localized. Okay, localized versus generalized. I am making the table column for easy for understanding. Okay, so localized definition is collection of the fluid in certain anatomical site. Only to the particular part will be collection of the fluid. Okay, where is generalized? Generalized another otherwise known as the anasarca. So collection of the fluid into the entire body or most of the part of the body will be fluid collection. So generalized edema otherwise known as the anasarca. Okay, examples. Examples of localized is inflammatory edema and lymphatic edema. And where there is a generalized edema, all the organ special type, cardiac edema, renal edema and nutrition edema comes under the generalized type. Okay, so what will be the causes of the localized edema? Causes of the localized edema is the decreased permeability of the small blood vessels due to infection. Any infection into the particular part. Okay, particular part. What happened? Suppose the eye vessels will be involved. So, swelling of the eye. So, that is only particular part. So, that is known as the localized edema. So, what will be generalized edema? That leads to the factors. Main factor is decreased PCOP and sodium and potassium retention. Okay, this is about the thing. So, things to remember in the localized, generalized. Generalized edema otherwise known as the anasarca. Okay. So, the type of edema is very important for the MCQs. The type of edema. Okay. Localized edema always exudate. Okay. And generalized edema mostly it is transudate. So we'll study what is meant by exudate and transudate. So this is the main important of the localized and generalized edema. Okay, what is this? Is the anasarca generalized edema? You can see the we can note it, the dilatation of the venules, everything. Okay, this is the we'll discuss later. Okay, so what is the difference between transudate and exudate? So transudate means what? Okay, collection of the fluid without increased vascular permeability. It is known as the transudate. In another word, it is only the collection of the fluid due to the pressure gradient. Only because of HP and PCOP is the problem, that is transudate. Okay, what is exudate? Collection of the fluid with increased vascular permeability. Okay, there is a without vascular permeability is a transudate, with vascular permeability is the exudate. Okay, what is the specific gravity? Specific gravity is here in the transudate is a less than 1.018, where there is exudate is more than 1.018. Okay, so characteristic of the fluid. Characteristic of the fluid is here it is protein containing is less than 3 gram per deciliter, where there is here in the exudate the protein content is more than 3 gram per deciliter, and here it is a more albumin, where there is a exudate is here it is a more fibrinogens. This is a very important for the pathology. Okay, next is the pH. pH is in the transudate is a less and in the exudate is a more. Okay, cellular infiltration. Okay, so transudate the cellular infiltration is absent, where there is a exudate the it is presence of polymorpho neutrophils or so many other cells. Okay, LDH, in case of transudate, LDH is low. Okay, lactose dehydrogenase. Okay, we have studied into the cell injury chapter. Any cell injury, the first cells, the first enzyme we have to detect during investigation is the LDH. So in case of transudate, it will be low, and in case of exudate, it will be high. Okay, so very important one. Examples of transudate is a congestive cardiac failure, and exudate is a pleural effusion. For simple thing, I am telling all inflammatory edemas are exudate. All inflammatory, because all inflammatory edema is producing increased vascular permeability as we discussed into the inflammatory chapter. So all inflammatory edemas are exudate, and here non-inflammatory edemas comes under the transudate. And examples are CCF and pleural effusions in case of exudate. Okay. Now we'll study what is pitting edema and non-pitting edema. Okay. So pitting edema is type, mostly pitting edemas are tender, that means painful, and non-pitting edema mostly is the non-painful, non-tender. Okay. So what is the mechanism? Here also it is a very simple mechanism. Increased, in case of pitting, increased interstitial fluid retention with the normal lymphatic drainage. Where there is a pitting edema, is the lymphatic drainage system is a normal. Where there is in the non-pitting edema, reduced lymphatic drainage, that means obstruction. Obstruction of the lymphatics is a mostly into the non-pitting type. So this is the differentiation. Okay. Example, in pitting edema, there is a generalized edema. All generalized edemas comes under the pitting edema. Where there is a non-pitting is the lymphadenoma and mixed edema is the examples of non-pitting. Here it is a difference is only thing. Here it is a in pitting, there is a lymphatic drainage is normal. Where there is non-pitting, lymphatic drainage is affected. Okay, so this is the one type of pitting and non-pitting. Okay, so this is about the pitting. When it comes to the clinical class, I will explain properly. Okay, so we'll study what is the pathogenesis and morphology of some important type of edema. Okay, so there is a four type of edema: renal edema, cardiac edema, pulmonary edema, and cerebral edema. We'll study one by one. So first we'll go for the renal edema. So what is renal edema? It is defined as generalized edema due to renal dysfunction, which appears first into the loose connective tissue, that is otherwise known as the periorbital edema. Okay, what is the periorbital edema? So see, this is the edema. So edema will appearing into the loose connective tissue. In the loose connective tissue, it is appearing into the eye or some other part of the body. So this is the definition of renal edema. Okay, so what is the causes? Okay, there are all the renal causes: nephrotic syndrome, glomerulonephritis, and acute tubular injury. Okay, what is the pathogenesis? In nephrotic syndrome, the pathogenesis is why the edema is occurring, because of decreased PCOP. We have said it, the protein content is less, that leads to decreased PCOP. In glomerulonephritis, okay, the glomeruls will not work properly. So what happened? Increased sodium and water retention, that is the pathology for producing the edema. Acute tubular injury, it is decreased glomerular filtration rate. So that will be decreased, leads to edema. Okay, so this is the simple pathogenesis. Okay, what is the simple pathogenesis? So this is the, we have studied into the renal. Okay, protein deficiency leads to decreased PCOP, decreased blood volume, decreased cardiac output, that leads to activation of RAS. Okay, that leads to edema. So this is the simple mechanism of the production of the renal edema. Okay, so what is the cardiac edema? We will study what is the cardiac edema. It is defined as generalized edema due to cardiac causes. Okay, so generalized edema due to cardiac causes. Example is CCF. Okay, so this is what happened: congestive cardiac failure. Okay, so the heart pump will not work properly. So if the pump is not working properly, leads to so much fluid accumulated into the venous system, that is a central venous pressure will be increases, that leads to HP will be increases, hydrostatic pressure is increases, leads to edema. So this is the cardiac edema. Okay, so let me will explain very properly difference between renal edema and cardiac edema. It is a very interesting one, it is very important one for the future study. Okay, what is the definition? In the renal edema, edema due to the renal causes. In cardiac edema, edema due to the cardiac causes. Very simple. Okay, the example also I told you. Cause: CCF, congestive cardiac failure, acute glomerulonephritis, and nephrotic syndrome. It is a cardiac causes. Okay, so what happened here in the pathogenesis? Pathogenesis, here it is decreased PCOP in the renal system, and cardiac system is a decreased cardiac output, as we have studied. Okay, and proteinuria in renal edema, it is present, and in the cardiac edema, it is absent. This is the way we have to, in the clinical symptom, we have to differentiate. And serum albumin level, where there is in the cardiac edema, it is a normal, where there is renal edema, it is a decrease. I told you normal serum albumin is 3.5 to 5 gram. Okay, and symptom, it's very important for the clinical symptom. When the renal edema first appear into the face, eye, 2 feet. Okay, where there is a cardiac edema, first appear into the lower limb. That means dependent edema. The word I am not written, but please note it down. It is a dependent edema. Dependent edema is a more common in the cardiac. That means first appearing into the lower limb to the eye. Okay, Okay, from down to the up. Here it is up to the down. This is the very clinical difference between the renal edema and the cardiac edema. Okay. Now we'll go for the pulmonary edema. So what is pulmonary edema? So it defined as localized edema in the airspace and lung parenchyma due to pulmonary causes leads to impaired gas exchange. Okay, edema accumulation into the airspace, alveoli and to the lung parenchyma, that leads to impaired gas exchange. This is a simple meaning of pulmonary edema. So the pulmonary edema for our understanding, cardiac causes and lung causes. Cardiac causes, one is congestive cardiac failure, that is mainly to the left side, and lung causes mainly to the ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome. Okay, so what is the pathogenesis? Simple pathogenesis as we discussed. Okay, congestive cardiac failure, that leads to what happened? Okay, the pump is not working, that leads to the pulmonary vascular pressure, venous pressure will be increases pulmonary vein. Okay, so that pressure of the pulmonary vein is increased, that leads to increased HP, okay, that leads to edema. So this is the simple understanding of the pulmonary edema. Okay, what is the another type? This is the last type, cerebral edema. So cerebral edema is defined as localized or generalized edema in the intracellular and extracellular edema of the brain leads to loss of consciousness and brain damage. So occurring the edema or fluid accumulation into the intracellular as well as into the extracellular. As we know, the cerebrum or central nervous system does not contain the lymphatics. So who's making the function? We'll study later. There are three types. Vasogenic cerebral edema, cytotoxic cerebral edema and interstitial cerebral edema. Okay, how to differentiate these three? I am making with a simple table column, I am making explanations. Okay, what is the cause? In the vasogenic, there is an inflammation is the main cause. Vaso means is the nervous issues, and cytotoxic means metabolic issues, and interstitial means there is a fluid issues, secretion of the fluid issue. Okay, we'll come one by one. Okay, and location, vasogenic appearing into the white matter, and where cytotoxic is appearing grey and white matter, and interstitial is appearing to the periventricular white matter. Okay, so BB, what is BBB? Brain blood barrier. Okay, this brain blood barrier is working as a lymphatics, like in the other part of the body where there is a brain don't have lymphatics. So what happened? So this is the important one for the investigations. So where there is a vasogenic, it is disturbed, it is decreased, BBB is decreased, where cytotoxic and interstitial it is the normal. Okay, what is the pathogenesis? So this is the pathogenesis is a very important again for the investigation. Here it is, as we know, it is a because of brain blood barrier is disturbed, that leads to vasogenic. Okay, where there is a sodium potassium pump defect, leads to defect into the cellular metabolism. So cellular defect, it is known as a cytotoxic, and there is a leakage of the CSF, cerebrospinal fluid. So that is known as the interstitium. Okay, the fluid content, okay, where there is vasogenic having high protein and sodium and potassium and no protein in case of cytotoxic, and interstitium is CSF without protein. That is the characteristic of interstitial cerebral edema. The last one, extracellular fluid in case of vasogenic and interstitium is increased, where cytotoxic is decreased. Everything, if you know the pathogenesis, the differentiation is very easy for the understanding. Okay, so now we'll see the last but not the least. The plasma protein level, edema produced when? Okay, the plasma protein level below 5 gram per deciliter. What is the normal? I told you 6 to 8 gram per deciliter is a normal. Okay, serum albumin level, when goes to below 2.5, the edema will be produced. So what is the normal? I told you 3.5 to 5 gram per deciliter. Okay, so pleural effusions. Pleural effusion means the accumulation of the fluid more than 300 ml. It is known as the pleural effusion. There is a difference between different words. I'll come to that. Okay, pleural effusions. Okay, so what is the normal pleural fluid? Okay, the normal pleural fluid is present in the lung cavity. Okay, normal is 10 to 20. When it comes to more than 30, it is known as the effusions. Okay, another difference between edema and effusion is, okay, effusions, okay, difference, main difference, edema and effusions. Effusion means it is mostly to the serous fluid, accumulation into the serous cavity. Edema is accumulation into the interstitial cavity. That is the difference. Okay. Pericardial tamponade. What is the word meaning of tamponade? Tamponade means Okay, where accumulation of the fluid producing the distress to the particular organ. Suppose the pericardium, so much accumulation of the fluid into the pericardium leads to discomfort to the or dysfunction of the heart function. That known as the word meaning of tamponade. Okay, pericardial tamponade, when to call the fluid accumulation into the pericardium more than 200 ml, it is known as the pericardial tamponade. What is the normal pericardium? Pericardial fluid containing 15 to 50 ml. It is more than 200 ml, you are calling it a pericardial tamponade. Okay, ascites. When the fluid accumulated, accumulation of the fluid in the peritoneal cavity, okay, is more than 25 to 30 ml. What is the normal? Normal is 5 to 20 ml. Okay, so and next one it is cardiac edema, mostly into the dependent edema. Okay, there is another word, is a dropsy. Okay, dropsy is the another word of edema. We have to make it, what is edema? Another name of edema is a dropsy. Okay, effusion means it is the mostly into the fluid accumulation into the serous fluid. Tamponade means it is producing the distress to the particular part of the organ. Okay, ascites means fluid present into the peritoneal, accumulation of the fluid into the peritoneal cavity. Cardiac edema, as we have discussed, into the dependent edema. And renal edema is nothing but the edema which is present with the loose connective tissue. Okay, loose connective matrix, that is the eye, face, etc. Okay, so that's all about the edema.
That's all about the edema. Next class we'll see about hyperemia and congestion. Thank you.